As those of you who followed the work of the Cato Institute know, we've long argued that courts over the years have so misinterpreted the Constitution that today the document serves primarily to authorize, not to limit, government. 20 years ago, for example, Randy Barnett and I spoke at a Cato conference on economic liberties in the judiciary, joining others at that conference to lament the demise of economic liberty under doctrines the New Deal Court had fashioned from whole cloth. Then in 1989, Cato co-published the first of Randy's two anthologies on the Ninth Amendment, the amendment that speaks to that great body of unenumerated rights the Constitution was meant to protect, but hadn't under various erroneous readings of the document. And in the years since, we've continued to urge the courts to restore the parts of the Constitution they've stripped away to make room for the modern welfare state, the very state the Constitution was written to guard against. But it remained to put that all together in one place. We now have that, this magnificent book by Randy Barnett that aims at nothing less, as the title says, than restoring the lost Constitution. Focusing on the Constitution's implicit presumption of liberty, Professor Barnett takes us not only to the document's first principles, but to the first principles of government as such. In the course of doing so, he shows systematically, clause by clause, where the courts have gone wrong and what they must do to restore constitutional government. It's a tour de force from beginning to end. Rather than my summarizing it any further, however, why don't we turn directly to the author, who'll give us an overview of his book for 20 or 25 minutes, after which we'll hear comments from Professor Walter Dellinger and then from Judge David Sentelle. With that, we'll open the forum up to questions from you in the audience, followed by a reception upstairs. Let me note before we begin, however, that the book is available outside at a reduced price, and you can purchase it and have it signed by the author. Randy Barnett is a senior fellow here at the Cato Institute. He is the Austin B. Fletcher Professor at Boston University School of Law. He has taught there cyber law, contracts, constitutional law, criminal law, evidence, agency and partnership, and jurisprudence. Before entering teaching, he was a criminal prosecutor for the Cook County State's Attorney's Office in Chicago, where he tried many felony cases. He's a graduate of Northwestern University and Harvard Law School. He has visited at Harvard, Northwestern, and elsewhere. He has lectured both in America and abroad, especially in Japan. And he is one of the lead attorneys for the Oakland Cannabis Cooperative cases now pending in California. And in fact, he recently won a case out there in the Ninth Circuit. His book, The Structure of Liberty, Justice and the Rule of Law, was published by Oxford University in 1998. As I noted, he is the author of editor of a two-volume anthology on the rights retained by the people on the Ninth Amendment, and a case book on contracts. He has appeared on many of the media that we're all familiar with, and he has written voluminously in the law journals. And so without further ado, would you please join me in welcoming Professor Randy Barnett.
Well, thank you, Roger, for that wonderful introduction. I want to thank the commentators for having so graciously given of their time to read this book and to come and comment on this book. It's oftentimes difficult to get people to read a whole book before to be a commentator, and so I'm very grateful to you for agreeing to do so. One of the sort of side benefits I hadn't really anticipated of doing this book tour that I'm on, I've done 10 schools and I have 30 schools more to visit on this book tour, is that I'm learning a lot about my thesis that I hadn't realized from the commentators I'm getting, and so I think that's going to be a great benefit. But anyway, I only have 20-25 minutes, so I'm going to get into my prepared remarks quickly so I can get out of them quickly and hear the comments that are forthcoming. On May 21st, 1972, Laszlo Toth, a 33-year-old Australian geologist, slipped into St. Peter's Basilica. Toth dashed past the guards, vaulted a marble balustrade, and attacked Michelangelo's Pieta with a sledgehammer. With 15 blows, he removed the virgin's arm at the elbow, knocked off a chunk of her nose, and chipped one of her eyelids. Now suppose that instead of the Pieta, a madman had managed to evade security at the National Archives and attack the original United States Constitution on display there. Using a knife, he's able to cut whole passages out of the Constitution. The nation would surely be appalled by this heinous act. Yet since the early years of the Republic, the justices of the Supreme Court have accomplished what no madman ever could, redact the Constitution by excising important parts of what it says. Just 30 years after ratification, the Supreme Court weakened both the Necessary and Proper Clauses and the Commerce Clause. In McCulloch versus Maryland, Chief Justice John Marshall equated the term necessary with mere convenience, thereby converting a matter of constitutional principle into one of legislative policy and effectively removing this textual constraint on legislation from the purview of judicial review. In essence, it became the convenient and proper clause after that. In Gibbons versus Ogden, Marshall began a loosening of the power to regulate commerce among the several states by affirming that the enumeration although he did affirm in his opinion in Gibbons versus Ogden that the enumeration presupposes something not enumerated and that something must be the exclusively internal commerce of a state, which was a good statement, in fact a statement that we're relying upon in our litigation in the medical cannabis cases, which do concern wholly intrastate transactions. He then proceeded to broaden the Commerce Clause beyond commerce that exists between state and state to include any internal commerce that, in his words, concerns more states than one. The next passage to be redacted was one that limited state power. In this case, it was the Privileges or Immunities Clause, and it was redacted and eliminated altogether. The Privileges or Immunities Clause says that no state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States. In 1873, a mere 5 years after its ratification, the Privileges or Immunities Clause was functionally ripped from the Constitution by a bare majority of the Supreme Court in the Slaughterhouse cases. In the 1903 case of Champion versus Ames, the Supreme Court, and this time it was the Supreme Court that's sometimes called the Lochner Supreme Court, broadened the Commerce Clause by interpreting the power of Congress to regulate or make regular commerce between state and state, also to include a power to prohibit, in this case it was to prohibit the sale of lottery tickets of which Congress disapproved. Later, when coupled with Marshall's expansive reading of the commerce power and even a further expansion under the New Deal, this turned out to give Congress the power to prohibit commerce of which it disapproved inside a state so long as that commerce concerned more states than one. In the 1940s, in cases such as Wickard versus Filburn, the court effectively ceded to Congress the power both to regulate and prohibit all intrastate commerce that, in its words, substantially affects interstate commerce. And with its broad interpretation of the Commerce Clause and the Necessary and Proper Clause, effectively eliminated from the Constitution was the 10th Amendment that says the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution or prohibited by it to the states are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. Also excised are two words from the very first sentence of the Constitution, which grants Congress all legislative powers herein granted, thereby referring to the enumerated power scheme. Those two words are now gone from the text, at least as a functional matter. Also cut from the text in the 1940s was the 9th Amendment that says the enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. In the 1947 case of United Public Workers versus Mitchell, Justice Reed confusingly asserts, quote, if granted power is found, necessarily the objection of invasion of those rights reserved by the 9th and 10th Amendments must fail. Now this sentence is confused on at least two grounds. First of all, it refers to rights reserved. The 9th Amendment speaks of rights retained. The 10th Amendment speaks of powers reserved. Secondly, it says rights reserved by the 9th and 10th Amendments, whereas the 9th Amendment speaks of rights, the 10th Amendment speaks of powers. Clearly Justice Reed was confused. But nevertheless, the upshot of the holding was that the 9th Amendment was going to be eliminated for the following reason. So long as the court could find under its boundless interpretation of the Commerce Clause and the Necessary and Proper Clause a proper power that the Congress was exercising, then the 9th Amendment could not be violated, which means it could not possibly ever be violated, which means it now was gone from the text. So over the past 200 years then, the Supreme Court has done what no madman like Laszlo Toth ever could do. Take a razor to the text of the Constitution. With these clauses removed, the Constitution enforced by the court is substantially different than the one you still can view in the National Archives. At its hands, what was once a system of islands of powers in a sea of individual liberty rights, at both the state and federal level, has become a system of islands of rights in a sea of federal and state power. And most modern constitutional scholarship consists of the effort to justify what the court has done. Now, for any of you who think this imagery of Laszlo Toth is perhaps a little violent or a little provocative, and perhaps it is, I ask you to consider the following. Imagine that this crazy person who gets into the National Archives is able to razor out just the right parts of the Constitution, just the parts that get in the way of government doing good and government doing what people want it to do. Well, why wouldn't all constitutional law professors applaud this wonderful improvement that's been made in the Constitution? And yet, in reality, I doubt they would. And I'm certain they would be as appalled by this heinous act as most of the public would be if they knew that the Supreme Court has effectively done the same thing by eliminating whole passages of the Constitution and only selectively enforcing the document. Now, as the Supreme Court gutted the textual limits on the federal government provided by the Commerce Clause, the Necessary and Proper Clause, and the Ninth Amendment, and on the states by the Privileges or Immunities Clause of the 14th Amendment, it adopted in their place a doctrine it called the presumption of constitutionality. Now, initially, this presumption was said to be rebuttable, like presumptions are supposed to be. But at least since the 1956 case of Williamson v. Lee Optical, unless a liberty is deemed by the court to be fundamental, and I'm going to get more to that in a moment, this so-called presumption is irrebuttable. And an irrebuttable presumption is not a presumption. It is a rule of law. But since the 1956 case of Williamson v. Lee Optical, in that case, Justice William O. Douglas essentially reasoned that the only justification a statute had to have in order to be justified was not a particular reason why the legislature did enact it that was good enough, but only that the court could imagine a possible reason why it might have enacted it that was reasonable. In which case, and in that opinion, there's a long paragraph about it might have done it for this reason, it might have done it for that reason. And with that degree of judicial discretion, I mean judicial deference to legislative discretion, what would be left of judicial review? Nothing would be left of judicial review. But of course, as you know, we do have judicial review. So what is the basis of judicial review in light of this deference that's been given to Congress and the states? Well, the basis is taken from, or at least initially taken from, a single footnote of a single case that was decided in 1938. A footnote so famous that if you identify it by number to any constitutional law professor, they'll recognize what it is. In fact, if you mention it to any law professor, they don't even have to teach constitutional law. They'll know which footnote I'm talking about. And this is, of course, the famous footnote 4 of Caroline Product. Just say footnote 4. There's actually an entry in an encyclopedia called footnote 4. That's how famous it is. Now, why is it so famous? It's famous because it defines the modern approach to constitutional rights. It begins as follows. There may be narrower scope for operation of the presumption of constitutionality when legislation appears on its face to be within a specific prohibition of the Constitution, such as those of the first 10 amendments, which are deemed equally specific when held to be embraced within the 14th. Let me just reread the middle passage of that sentence. That when legislation appears on its face to be within a specific prohibition of the Constitution, then the presumption of constitutionality can be rebutted, and now the government must justify what it's doing. And this turns out to represent the entire, with some modification I'm about to discuss, the entire modern theory of constitutional rights. Presume all laws to be valid, except when an enumerated right listed in the Bill of Rights is infringed, in which case the court will then put the burden on the legislature or the executive to show that their actions are both necessary and proper. Gone now is the enumerated powers scheme, and in its place is a sole reliance on some of the rights that are enumerated in the Bill of Rights. And I say only some because, as some of you may realize, the Second Amendment's prohibition on laws that infringe the right to keep and bear arms has never been deemed by the court to be a fundamental right, even though it's one of those express prohibitions that happens to be in the Bill of Rights. Now, for 20 years, the Supreme Court remained within this footnote 4 framework. Then, in the 1965 case of Griswold versus Connecticut, it struck down a ban on the use and sale of contraceptives because it said the law violated a right of privacy. Trying desperately to remain within the confines of footnote 4, in his opinion, and his opinion in Williamson v. Lee Optical, Justice Douglas attempted, now infamously, to ground this right in in the following way. He grounded this right in, quote, specific guarantees in the Bill of Rights, which have penumbras formed by emanations from those guarantees that help give them life and substance. Now, this penumbras and emanations language is kind of a laugh line in certain circles, and perhaps for good reason. But I think that the history that I've just related explains why Justice Douglas resorted to penumbras and emanations. He was trying to stay within the footnote 4 theory that limited judicial review to those specifically enumerated rights, and when he was enforcing this one that wasn't there. And so he used emanations and penumbras to connect the right he was enforcing to a specific prohibition in the Constitution. But emanations and penumbras could not conceal the fact that the court had now escaped the bounds of footnote 4, the bounds that the straitjacket provided by footnote 4. And after that, all hell broke loose. The court came under withering fire from former New Dealer constitutional scholars who, however much they might have agreed with the outcome, could see no natural stopping point short of a return to the pre-New Deal scrutiny of state and federal legislations. In response to this onslaught, the court adopted a doctrine which has turned out to be very problematic. It limited its protection of unenumerated rights, the ones that are going to go beyond the specific prohibitions, to those that it, in its opinion, were deeply rooted in the nation's tradition and history or implicit in the concept of ordered liberty. Now courts were going to be in the business of picking those rights which are fundamental from those rights which were not fundamental, those liberties which are important from those liberties which are to be sacrificed to the will of the majority. That's an uncomfortable position for the court to be in. But there's another hidden problem of this approach to fundamental rights that isn't often recognized, and that is the outcome of its of the protections it affords depends entirely on how the right is going to be defined. So if, for example, you define a right narrowly, or such as a constitutional right of homosexuals to engage in acts of sodomy, or a constitutional right to use medical cannabis, obviously that right can be disparaged, if not denied altogether, by saying, well, just where in the Constitution does it say that? But if, on the other hand, you broaden the right out to defend it as a general right to liberty, obviously a general right to liberty is deeply rooted in our nation's tradition and history. And in the case of medical cannabis, a broader version of that right is simply the right to be free of unnecessary pain and suffering, and the right to preserve one's life. That seems clearly rooted in our nation's tradition and history, as well as implicit in the concept of ordered liberty. And yet, this all depends on how you choose to define the right. And here's the secret problem. There is no right way to define the right. There's no correct way. Both are right. One is simply a general version. The other is a more specific version, except doing it one way leads to one outcome. Doing it another way leads to another outcome. And any doctrine that is so easily manipulable, so would lead to whatever outcome you want, is not genuinely a doctrine at all. And it's something that's going to lead to fewer judicial choice as to which rights it's going to protect and which rights it's not. In my book, Restoring the Lost Constitution, I propose we chuck that system, and in its place, and in the place of the presumption of constitutionality, we adopt a presumption of liberty, which would essentially protect liberty across the board. Now, I don't have that much more time, and I really don't want to eat into the time of my commentators. But let me just briefly summarize before closing what I believe this how this approach would work, just so that you have some taste of it. With a presumption of liberty, the government would have the burden of showing that its laws were both necessary and proper. At the federal level, it would have to show that a law was truly necessary to accomplish one of its enumerated powers, properly interpreted. At the state level, a law would have to be shown to be truly necessary to the exercise of a proper conception of the police power of states, and I devote a whole chapter of the book to what is the proper conception of the police power of states. To oversimplify a bit, Congress with respect to interstate commerce and the states with respect to all other liberties could regulate rightful and prohibit wrongful acts. And to illustrate what I mean by that, consider the right of free speech. In the right of free speech, we have rightful exercises of free speech that can still be regulated according to time, place, and manner restrictions in order to protect the rights of other people. But those time, place, and manner restrictions or regulations must be scrutinized to see that they're reasonable and necessary and not some pretext for actually prohibiting speech. On the other hand, in contrast, we can prohibit wrongful exercises of speech, such as speech that constitutes defamation or speech that constitutes fraud. Those sorts of speech cannot merely be regulated, they can also be prohibited. What the presumption of liberty would do is extend the same protective presumption that is now afforded speech, press, and assembly simply to all liberty, rightly defined. In which case, this would not be an express prohibition on regulation. It would simply put the burden on the government to explain why it is such regulations are in fact necessary and proper. Why it is, what is their justification for regulation? Something that under current fundamental rights jurisprudence, the government simply does not have to do. It never has to justify what it's doing unless you can first establish that the liberty is a fundamental one, and which means it really has a carte blanche. Let me close now by emphasizing the following point. To justify its presumption of constitutionality, the Supreme Court had to eliminate passages of the Constitution that inconveniently stood in its way, which is a good reason, I submit, for rejecting this doctrine as unconstitutional. A presumption of liberty would restore this lost Constitution by holding Congress to its enumerated powers and states to their proper police power, while protecting the privileges or immunities of citizens and the rights retained by the people. For despite the best efforts of the Supreme Court over the past two centuries, all these portions of the lost Constitution are still to be found in the duly enacted Constitution of the United States. But you don't have to take my word for it. You can look it up. Thanks.
Well, thank you very much, Randy. That was a very concise overview and got to the heart of the matter. Now let's see what Walter Dellinger and David Sentelle are going to say about it. I'll introduce them separately just before they speak. Walter Dellinger is a professor of law at Duke University. He's the Douglas B. Maggs Professor of Law. He's also the head of the appellate practice division at the Washington, D.C. law firm of O'Melveny and Myers. In 1997, he served as acting Solicitor General under the late unlamented Clinton administration. And in that capacity, he argued nine cases before the Supreme Court. Before that, he was advisor to the President and head of the Office of Legal Counsel in the Department of Justice. He is a graduate of the University of North Carolina and the Yale University Law School. He has published voluminously in the Harvard Law Review, Yale Law Journal, Duke Law Journal, and elsewhere. He's appeared in all the usual TV programs, and he is one of the major legal figures here in Washington today. Would you please welcome Walter Dellinger?
I love this wonderful book. This is a great book, Randy, and you should be very, very, very proud of it. And it's powerfully argued. It has a coherent thesis. It's full of nuance and detail. It both looks at the sweep of history. It does it in light of an understanding of the basic postulates of the Constitution. It deals with cases in ways that are enriching. I learned from every chapter of this book, and there is much of it with which I agree. In my 10 minutes, I think I'll emphasize that with which I don't agree. Let me just start by saying the things on which Randy and I are in agreement, in which I'm so pleased to find so powerfully argued and finding fresh support from positions I'd stumbled into. The proposition, for example, that there are rights that preexisted the Constitution of the United States, and that the framers at Philadelphia, during the debates, understood that they were operating against a background of rights that already existed. They weren't merely creating rights on a blank slate. There's one wonderful moment, for example, when in debating the issue of whether there should be lower federal courts, Madison refers to the double jeopardy principle that would prevent the government from appealing from an acquittal. And I ask my students as we read the debates in the Constitutional Convention, what double jeopardy clause? This is 1787. There's no Bill of Rights. They're not even going to have one. But there's an assumption that, of course, judges would enforce the right against being twice put in jeopardy. You didn't have to write that down. We agree that, I think, Randy, as I developed the Simon lecture that I delivered here for Cato into a written document, I will welcome your comments on a draft. The thesis of that lecture was one that is finds more support in your book than I knew that there was. The thesis was that the disparagement by some liberal scholars and jurists of the constitutional protection of rights of contract and property has actually weakened the protection of other personal liberties, and similarly the disparagement by some conservative scholars of unenumerated personal liberties has in fact weakened the protection of rights of property, and that when you go back to Madison, you can see how fully both are included in the 10th Federalist. He moves from rights against paper money and the seizure of property to protection of religious minorities against other sects. He speaks about the use of color as the basis of the most oppressive dominion ever known. All is of a piece to Madison's generation and to libertarians. I think Randy's book does the best job yet, I think, of showing how wrong the slaughterhouse case was that stripped the 14th Amendment of much of its power when the court held that a monopoly that served no purpose except to exclude persons from lawful occupations did not violate the 14th Amendment, was not within the range of the privileges and immunities protected. Randy and I both agree that that was wrongly decided, and he argues that more powerfully, and does see the 14th Amendment as having made an important change in our Constitution. I very much like the passage at page 203, for example, where Randy says, "The 14th Amendment was born of a newfound distrust of state governments." And he notes that before and after the Civil War, the civil liberties, it wasn't just about racial discrimination and the sequelae of slavery. Before and after the Civil War, the civil liberties of white unionists in the South and abolitionists in the North who happened to stray into the South, including their liberties to speech, assembly, and the right to bear arms, were severely restricted by the Southern governments, much to the dismay of Northern Republicans, and creating an enormous distrust of those state governments in the aftermath of the Civil War. There was also the very strong Republican notion of free labor, which is also of a piece of this notion that rights are indivisible. The notion of free labor, which you still see reflected in the party of Lincoln at its best, even those occupational liberties far removed from slavery and its vestiges, were part of the Lincoln case against slavery, the freedom to pursue one's occupation. To enjoy the fruits of one's own labors was so much at the heart of the case that Lincoln made against depriving others of the freedom of their labor, that rights of occupational freedom are fully included within the 14th Amendment. With all of that, we agree. He has a very good explanation of the way in which the American culture became more at ease with governmental power, particularly the power of the national government, which we're getting close to the place where we part company. He has a very good explanation. The American Civil War, Randy writes, enhanced the moral authority of the central government and undermined the moral appeal of true federalism. And it really was a transformative event. The Civil War was not simply the largest project in terms of men, material, and money the federal government had ever undertaken. It was greater in size and scope than every project of the national government from the time of the convention to the time of the Civil War combined. It truly transformed this into a national government that may or may not have been there on paper. In 1850, the United States Department of Justice consisted of a part-time attorney general, two clerks, and a messenger. After the Civil War, you have built the magnificent executive office building to house the departments of state, navy, and war. That enormous building was inconceivable before the Civil War, that you would need such an enormous building to house the federal government. when the Justice Department existed in a rooming house. And I'm not speaking metaphorically there. I'm literally, the Attorney General moved into a rooming house that had two clerks. So the 14th Amendment was almost not thinkable before the Civil War. It would have been such a ridiculous assertion in 1830 that the federal government was going to hold itself out as protecting the rights of the citizen of Georgia against his or her own state government. With what resources? After the Civil War, you've transformed the authority. I think Randy has more concern about that than I do. I guess my libertarian streak has never extended to the notion of distinguishing very much between governments, national and state. And I actually think in the national government, in the extended federal republic, there is much protection for liberties. I would join Randy in invalidating federal legislation as well as state legislation that, for example, set up licensure provisions otherwise interfered with free markets. I think Lincoln Federal, when Justice Black abandons any judicial scrutiny of economic legislation, is wrong. I'm more comfortable with national power. I think Randy does not persuade me. If you read his chapters on the Necessary and Proper Clause, my only anecdote would be set aside a little time to read what I think is the greatest of the judicial opinions, Justice Marshall's opinion in McCulloch against Maryland. I think Marshall comes off somewhat better, but you know, that's pretty good praise. You know, he was a heavy hitter. Let me close. Let's see where we're doing on time. Let me close with one point of disagreement. You're wonderfully in your skewering of Schechter Poultry. That there are parts of the National New Deal enterprise I join you in criticizing. But here's the troublesome point, I think, for all of us. The subtitle of Restoring the Lost Constitution is the Presumption of Liberty. And when you think of it as a presumption of liberty, that government ought to have to justify its restrictions rather than having the person whose liberty is burdened carry the day of showing why the government restriction is inappropriate. Is very powerful, but its critics will see this as a mandate for greater judicial activism than some of us would find tolerable. I think Randy's response would appropriately be, it's just as much judicial activism to fail to invalidate a law that should be invalidated as it is to strike one down that shouldn't be. Nonetheless, to the degree that, as a practical matter, at the end of the day, courts produce results that are different from those reached by the elected political branches of the government, I do think there is a continuing concern about that. And I'll pick out one case which comes in for praise at page 220 of Randy's book, Railroad Retirement Board versus Alton Railroad. It's a fairly obscure case, but I think a pretty good example of how I think the New Deal court was too aggressive in scaling back on the authority of the national government and too willing to substitute its own judgment for legislative judgment. It'll give you a good example of where we may divide at this point. At issue in the Railroad Retirement Board case was the Railroad Retirement Act, an act of Congress in 1935, before Social Security was even constitutionally possible, to provide for pensions for railroad employees, enacted under the Commerce Clause. Mandatory retirement at 65, extended to age 70 year by year, with a compulsory retirement plan funded one-third by employees and two-thirds by the railroads. Everybody would agree that acts of Congress that increase the efficiency, well, I should say not everybody agrees, but I would assume that an act of Congress that increases the efficiency of railroad transportation is within the power to regulate interstate commerce by making sure that it flows freely. This is not guns near schools. This is real commerce. So the issue is whether this act, in fact, is one that promotes the efficiency of railroads. To the court's majority that struck it down, they saw the real purpose of the statute was not the regulation of commerce, but the enhancement of social welfare of workers beyond the terms voluntarily agreed to with their employment. And they looked at the rationale put forth by Congress. Congress had a year of hearings, and it really built a record. And the record was both from what was done in Europe and what was done voluntarily in business. Business people came and testified that when they adopted a retirement plan for superannuated employees with a pension, that the increasing longevity of employment, the movement away of older workers, and the increased loyalty and morale and security increased efficiency. That's the theory of why it's an appropriate exercise of commerce. And there is a sentence that just leaps out in the opinion where the court says, we've looked at all of that that Congress looked at. And I can quote four words exactly. We do not agree that a pension plan, if compelled by Congress, would actually promote loyalty and efficiency and economy. We don't agree. I think at the end of the day, that is too intrusive into the democratic process so that I would be less willing to go that last step, and that's the concern about how far one carries the presumption of liberty. But I must say that those are remarks that are a small criticism of what is a powerfully argued and in large measure convincing work. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Walter. I couldn't help but wondering why, if the pension plan did indeed increase efficiency, the railroads didn't leap to it. Anyway, let's turn now to our final speaker, and we've turned to North Carolina for both of our speakers today. Judge David Sentelle was appointed to the United States Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit in October of 1987. He, too, is a graduate of the University of North Carolina, both the college and the law school there. He has had an interesting and varied legal career. Following law school, he practiced in private practice in North Carolina. Then he became the assistant U.S. attorney in Charlotte, North Carolina. From there, he served as a North Carolina state judge. After that, he went back into private practice and finally became a federal district judge in North Carolina and then a judge on the Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit. Judge Sentelle appears frequently at events here in Washington and around the country, especially for the Federalist Society. He is also an author himself, most recently, of a wonderful little volume published by the Green Bag Press. Those of you who are lawyers will be familiar with that press, entitled Judge Dave and the Rainbow People. I will let that title hang there for your notice. Would you please welcome Judge David Sentelle?
Raise this up just a little. Walter and I were, in fact, at UNC together. We did not know each other, which probably means Walter didn't hang out in bars very much in Chapel Hill. I will take the opposite tack from Walter and begin with where I disagree with our author, and at the same time I will disagree with one of the blurbs on the back of the book and with the advertising circular put out by Cato. My old friend Sandy Sanford Levinson states that the book should attract general readers as well. Cato says that he, referring to Professor Barnett, provides a new, more realistic theory of constitutional legitimacy. I question whether there can be a theory of constitutional legitimacy after over 200 years of constitutional history and acceptance of legitimacy that can be in any sense realistic. The fact that Professor Barnett spends over 40 pages belaboring the new theory convinces me he won't get very many general readers unless they are advised to skip that portion and jump directly to the meat. I had supposed and still suppose that the legitimacy of the Constitution relies upon and rests upon the consent of the governed. Professor Barnett says that can't be so because the consent is not unanimous. Neither I nor anyone else had ever supposed that it was, but most of us suppose that man in a state of nature joins in governments for the protection of the rights, life, liberty of all, and where a system of government for the protection of those assets is devised by a representative body in the most representative Republican form available, and then the most in the history of the world, and where it contains the seeds of its own amendment, the lack of unanimity simply bespeaks the fact that unanimity in such an endeavor is impossible. Professor Barnett says it is possible. Look at Leisure World. I looked at Leisure World and couldn't find any parallel to a system of government. So I would repair to the proposition that without government, life would be nasty, brutish, and short, as opposed to those of us who are nasty, brutish, and tall. And that when we are told instead that the Constitution's legitimacy rests on a theory that a legitimate lawmaking process is one that provides adequate assurances, this is from page 45, that the laws it validates are just in this respect, that respect being, for a law is just, and this is page 44, and therefore binding in conscience if its restrictions are necessary to protect the rights of others and proper insofar as they do not violate the pre-existing rights of the persons on whom they are imposed. I don't think many general readers who have grown up steeped in the proposition that government rests upon, the legitimacy of the Constitution rests upon some form of consent of the governed, are going to be very patient with a 45-page discourse that ends with a subjective new standard. And I think they're going to be troubled by the proposition that this Constitution was questionable in its legitimacy for over 200 years and only became legitimate when a professor from Massachusetts provided us with a subjective standard by which he found it legitimate. That said, I strongly advise you to read the book. I just advise you to skip the first 45 or so pages and go directly to the parts that I agree with. When we get to the part about how to interpret the Constitution, I've never seen a better exposition of what proper methodology is, and that is an originalism that differs from some of the originalism you hear described and differs from it in a way that is, I think, entirely correct and is well defended by Professor Barnett both in logic and in history, and that is that we should be seeking not the original intent of the framers, which is an unfortunate phrase that is used sometimes accidentally and sometimes intentionally by originalists of one sort and another. We should instead be looking for the original meaning of the Constitution. The very essence of writtenness is an important theme of that portion of Professor Barnett's text, and you are losing the value of writtenness if you begin to try to determine, well, what did Hamilton and Madison and the others intend to frame, which was not at all the same thing as each other in many instances. The question is not what did they mean to frame, but what did they frame? What they did frame is put down in the Constitution, and I think Professor Barnett's thesis that that is the originalism to which we should look is irrefutable. I cannot say that the idea is novel, and that to me is not a criticism. That's an encomium to him, that it isn't a novel idea. It is, in fact, the original idea to which he is calling for a return. We entered this written compact so that persons now, they would say, and persons in generations to come, can determine precisely what are the limitations of government. And I think that, again, is the right question. And when we go far beyond the text of the Constitution and the contemporary sources, both within and without constitutional history, that will tell us what the words meant, we run the risk of trying to frame the Constitution that we think they would like to have had rather than the one that they, in fact, were able to get the representatives of the people to agree upon and found a legitimate government that protected the pre-existing liberties. That said, then, we come to the part of the book that I partly agree with. We've been through the part I disagree with, that is to say, the one that says the Constitution is questionable in its legitimacy until I find it legitimate. I would say that, again, for the general reader, this reminded me of the thought of someone coming forth with a new and exciting translation of the Odyssey and spending the first 50 pages writing on why the professor is able to prove that the Odyssey was not written by the blind Greek named Homer that most scholars have previously thought, but was in fact written by another blind Greek named Homer. I don't think many of us would labor with that very long. We would be interested in what the text has to say about the substance. And here again, what the text has to say about this substance is most compelling. And in so far as the methodology, it's irrefutable. Now, when we come to the application of that methodology to the subjects of the Ninth Amendment, the necessary and proper clause, privileges and immunities, and privileges or immunities, whether we're speaking of the federal or the limitations on the states, I'm not sure that I agree or disagree with everything that the professor concludes. But I would say that his examination is quite thorough and quite convincing, and I approach it only with the skepticism inherent in the Article III position that I occupy, and that is, I'm not going to decide its specific application until I hear the other side argue as well. But there are points in it that I have heard argued and am thoroughly convinced about. One of them is one to which, in your limited time, you alluded today, but in your book you explore at much greater length, and that is the enumerated powers, more specifically the Commerce Clause. I believe that with proper attention to the limitations that are well explored in the text, we will have fairly little reason to have to enter that realm of what rights do courts believe are protected by the Ninth Amendment, and what privileges and immunities are those that must be afforded to the citizens. That is to say, and the book says it well, if the acts of the federal government are limited to those areas that are enumerated, and if the courts listen to that limitation on enumeration, then we may never reach the point of asking, is the right which this citizen is asserting one that is in fact protected either explicitly or implicitly by the Ninth Amendment or by some emanation or penumbra? And frankly, that bothers me a great deal, the emanations and penumbras. I did go down and look at the original Constitution, and I couldn't find it anywhere unless it's that green haze that hangs over it in said case. I'm a little more optimistic about the possibility of convincing courts of the efficacy of a return to the doctrine of enumerated powers than I am of the possibility of getting very far with a proposition that asks the courts to begin to outline what rights it is that are not to be disparaged or denied because of the Ninth Amendment. And that really is all. The Ninth Amendment speaks in terms of powers granted and not rights, but that's really all it says. The enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed, it speaks of rights and not powers, to deny or disparage others retained by the people. I don't know, and I'm not likely to find out, what all those rights are. In fact, as Barnett carefully lays forth, you're not supposed to know. There's a lot of history that says that the people at the Constitutional Convention say, we don't know what all the rights are. And the people in the ratification conventions and the people in the early Congress, we don't know what all the rights are. We just want to, we will not lay out or try to lay out what they all are. Some of them are trivial. But we will limit the power of the federal government. And I think the 10th Amendment and the 9th Amendment, as you defend, were well designed to draw that line around around the powers of government in such a fashion that it should be a seldom thing that we actually have to come down to saying, is this right one that the framers intended to protect under the Ninth Amendment, or is this power one intended to be denied under the 10th Amendment, because they told us rather plainly what rights they were handing out. Perhaps the best example, and one very dear to my heart, is the one to which you alluded and which you argue more thoroughly in the greater time available to you in the book, and that is the Interstate Commerce Clause. As you noted today, the Supreme Court has lost all sense of that interstate having any real meaning or content and have stretched it beyond all recognition. As you further lay out in the text, the word commerce itself is one that has great limiting force and one that has been ignored, in my view, even more than the interstate character has. Perhaps because I lost a fight over this very question, what the Supreme Court has done to these clauses sometimes is not nearly as baffling as what the lower courts have done. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the case of the National Association of Home Builders involving the California highway building project that was stopped because of the habitat of an endangered fly. Now, while I could not find anything interstate in the character of an inveterate stay-at-home like the deli stand's flower-loving fly, neither could I find any commerce in its living or dying. Two of my colleagues, in separate opinions, the gist of which escaped me, did. I wrote the dissent, which tells you what the law isn't, but the Supreme Court failed worse than I did. They didn't grant cert. When we come to the specifics of application, I think, and it's not fair to criticize somebody for not having written everything in a book I'd like in there, but I would like to have had more thought on whether there is any real possibility of in fact doing what you're suggesting here, and that is restoring the lost constitution. It's not going to be restored on the ground as opposed to in theory unless some method is found of selling the courts upon it. I think the possibility of selling the courts is better in the area of the enumerated powers than it is in resort to the Ninth Amendment. I'm not suggesting that I share Bob Bork's view that this is like an ink blot on the page and you can't tell what it means. We're supposed to interpret or construe the entire Constitution. That's part of it, and we're obligated, if necessary, when we have a case in controversy, to find some meaning. But if we look to the limits of federal power, and those are rather plainly laid out, then maybe we never get to the question of what those rights are. In any sense, in your own Professor Barnett's own terms, to decide what that Ninth Amendment means is more construction than interpretation. Courts are dangerous when they start doing a lot of construction. If you think not, then look at the history of what Professor Barnett in the book and here today has laid out. So again, to summarize, with reference to the supposed new justification for the legitimacy of the Constitution, I'd skip that part. With respect to the method of interpreting and reading the Constitution, that is the true originalism of original meaning, I think the text is irrefutable, and while I have read, as Professor Dellinger suggested, many of the things that Professor Barnett had to say in other places, I've never seen them put together in a compact, concise, reasoned argument in one place as well as they're put forth here. When you come down to the specifics of how that interpretation applies to specific parts of the Constitution, the book is fascinating, and I expect it to be the subject of a lot of controversy and writing and discussion by others. I reserve judgment on those specifics until they come to me in an Article III case or controversy. Thank you.
Well, I have to say, as an author, I'm quite thrilled by these comments. I'm certainly far more thrilled by the areas of agreement that we have than I am dismayed by the areas of disagreement that we have, and not exactly the reaction I was expecting, and I'm very, very pleased. I'm going to, in some sense, in gratitude, limit my responses just to a couple of points, in fact, the two main areas of disagreement. Let me just emphasize one very important agreement I have with Judge Sentelle, and he knows this because it's in the book, and that is I really do think that if the enumerated power scheme was properly interpreted, there would be many, many fewer opportunities or need to resort to any sort of protection of rights, enumerated or unenumerated, which is the reason why it wasn't until as late as 1965 that the first act of Congress was struck down because it violated the First Amendment, freedom of speech. That's very late in our history. There's a reason why it took so long for these rights, this rights jurisprudence to develop, because it took a while for the enumerated power scheme to unwind. And once it did, then all we had left to protect liberty were these rights. And a lot, far too much premium is placed on that by the by the erosion of the enumerated power scheme. And Lopez versus United States is a perfect example of that, because it was found, the Gun-Free School Zone Act was found to be outside the commerce power of Congress. You never had to reach the issue of whether the Second Amendment might have prohibited that. So that just gives you an idea of the extent to which I think that Judge Sentelle is right about this. And I think we all must keep that in mind. I just want to talk about two points. I want to talk about the first 45 pages on legitimacy, and then I want to talk about the issue of judicial activism. I'll close on that. As for the first 45 pages, I have a confession to make as an author, and I hate to do this in such a large audience, but the confession I make as an author is I wish I didn't have to write that first 45 pages and put it first, because I do think that it could be a screen that would prevent people from moving beyond the first 45 pages. But I quite frankly, after considering long and hard if it was possible to avoid doing so, I concluded reluctantly that it wasn't. The reason being that I do find the prevailing consent of the governed theory of constitutional legitimacy to be wholly inadequate. And not only is it inadequate, it actually ends up being a weapon against the legitimacy of the Constitution. Because once you start taking the consent of the governed idea very seriously, first of all, you're then moved to see, well, just how much consent was there at the formation of the government, and then you're going to find what there was voting by a majority of delegates selected to conventions that might or might not represent a majority of people in the population at the time. And then the question always arises in political theory as to how can a majority bind a minority? How can a majority by its consent bind a minority? And that's just taking the founding as your starting point. Then you have the next question, which is always raised, and that is why would the consent of those who were living 200 years ago bind us today? Now, I'm not going to belabor all the problems with this position. The 45 pages is mostly spent explaining why this concept of consent of the governed is problematic. It's not spent justifying the alternative. It's spent showing why this is a serious problem. But I think the alternative is significant. It's actually rather simple. And it isn't just the opinion of a Massachusetts professor, although I really consider myself more a Chicago boy than a Massachusetts professor. But I think, what is even at the heart of what Judge Sentelle gave as his explanation of legitimacy. And that is, if you have a process of government that, if you have a system of government that provides procedural assurances that it's going to protect the rights retained by the people, and it doesn't violate the rights of the people on whom it's imposed, then that government is legitimate. You know, doing this by means of conventions in which you have these things hammered out and you have these majoritarian votes is one way of accomplishing it. Of course, conquering countries like we did to Japan and imposing a constitution on them is another way of doing it, not the way I'd normally recommend, but it didn't work out too badly for them. But the upshot of this is not where the Constitution came from, but how good a constitution is it? And it isn't a subjective judgment, or let's put it this way, it is no more a subjective judgment to decide whether a constitution does effectively protect rights than it is to decide whether there really was, at any given time, consent of the governed. That's also an opinion that we have to reach after analysis here and now. So I think, reluctantly, I had to put the 45 pages in, and I would, in fact, urge you to read it. But the truth of the matter is, if you did skip it, and you skip to the next chapter, that'd be perfectly fine, provided that you buy the book. Now, the last I want to talk about is the issue of judicial activism. I'm tempted simply to leave it at an aphorism that I put in that Cato journal all those 20 years ago when I said in that article, before I really was a constitutional, I was just a contracts professor then, and that was, judicial activism in pursuit of liberty is no vice, and judicial restraint in pursuit of justice is no virtue. To paraphrase someone or another, Carl Hess or somebody. But I'm not going to just say that. I won't just rest on that. I think the judicial activism point is an interesting one, because the term judicial activism, in my opinion, is almost completely empty of meaning. I've never used the term judicial activism to criticize a court, except once, and that was to criticize the Florida Supreme Court in Bush v. Gore in an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal in between their ruling and the subsequent reversal by the Supreme Court of the United States. And that was only because I was adopting the view that I'm adopting here, which is it is simply judicial activism to ignore the Constitution. That is the only that's the only definition of judicial activism that actually has any substance to me. Otherwise, it's basically a word you use to criticize courts when they strike down legislation that you approve of. It certainly can't be something, unless you believe the court should never strike down popularly elected legislation that's the product of the supposedly more democratic branches, then you are going to have to pick and choose when they're supposed to do it and when they're not supposed to do it. What's the ultimate criterion of when they're supposed to do it and when they're not supposed to do it? On my thesis, the ultimate criterion is, does the Constitution permit this, or does the Constitution not permit this? So the ultimate criterion of activism is whether the Constitution allows this behavior on the part of government, and it's the first duty of judges to say no if it doesn't. And that is not activism if, in fact, they are enforcing the Constitution. And so on that note, I would suggest that we have to consider judges not to be the superiors of the other branches of government, but to be the equals of the other branches of government. And in order, and before a particular law is found to be constitutional, all three branches of government must agree. And if one branch of government, like the judiciary, is going to defer to the other branches of government under, as they do under the presumption of constitutionality, then we have lost a serious safeguard that was built into our original Constitution. Thanks.
All right, thank you. I'm going to take the prerogative of the chair to ask three quick questions, and if you could give three quick answers, please. Walter, why don't you pick up on that point that I raised, the Railroad Retirement Act, you said was one place where you disagreed with Randy because it was an example you thought of judicial activism in the court, substituting its judgment for that of the legislature as to whether the imposition of this compulsory scheme would increase efficiency. The court may have said simply that we're not substituting our judgment, but rather, if indeed this would have increased efficiency, then why is it we didn't leave it to the railroads themselves to implement this retirement program rather than have Congress do it?
You know, I think that is on balance a convincing point, but
good.
It takes
then
me right
back.
But it takes me right back to Randy's point, which is to say that Randy's last point about judicial activism, I love being the apostle of judicial restraint on this panel, by the way. Randy's a point about judicial activism in some sense assumes that these are sort of black and white answers, and that, you know, you're an activist court if you fail to, or you're acting not probably, if you fail to strike down what you should strike down. But there are questions on which human judgment may pause. And I think there's certain judges like John Marshall Harlan II who will often think, well, I think this act is not one that necessarily accomplishes the objective, but people in Congress disagree, and there's room for disagreement, and I'll stay my hand. I mean, there's an attitude of mind, a disposition, to think that others' judgment may be entitled to some respect, even if you would differ with it. And so, even if your point is well taken, that's a debate. Congress heard that argument as well, and Congress resolved it. And it doesn't seem clear to me that there is a basis for saying that you should strike it down.
Okay, fair enough. David, you suggested that the founders were of the view that we're not supposed to know all the rights that we have. And indeed, Randy makes the point that has to be the case because there are an infinite number of descriptions of our rights, and obviously none of us can know infinity. However, you then went on to say that courts are more likely to secure enumerated powers than unenumerated rights, even though both doctrines are part of the Constitution. Well, I can understand that coming from a judge who is, let us say, of the conservative persuasion. Maybe judges of a more liberal persuasion might think just the opposite, and maybe it is the case that, and I have the Lawrence case in mind here, where it was an unenumerated right that was secured by that decision, that it's possible that we can have both secured as we go along, that is to say, liberal judges securing unenumerated rights and conservative judges reviving the doctrine of unenumerated powers.
I think perhaps it's a difference of emphasis rather than a difference in totality, and both topics are taken up and well discussed in the text, but there is, in the real world, as to whether you're going to get anything restored or not, the question of whether you're going to be able to get first majority opinions and second majority opinions that are going to gain the fealty of the public and the political branches. And Lawrence may be a good example of a case that you're not going to like the long-range upshot of, because when the courts go out to identify
well,
a right...
Well, it affects me not at all. Let me make that very clear.
Well, let me finish. Yeah.
Lawrence, I mean.
Lawrence enumerates a right that you're going to have a hard time convincing most people exists, or a great many people exists, and you may find more tinkering with the Constitution and more attempts at court packing or court circumvention if the courts are attempting to come up with previously unprotected rights and write them into the meaning of the Ninth Amendment mm-hmm. or the fundamental liberties of the fourth footnote or any other source, than if you simply have cases like Lopez, to which Professor Barnett alluded, where the court draws back and says the government just doesn't have that power. I will grant you the question of the guns-free school zones was and perhaps remains a controversy, but nobody's out drafting amendments to the Constitution. Nobody's trying to run around the court on the subject of there are limits to the enumerated powers. Walter and I were seated not next to each other, but very close together during the argument. Sandra Day O'Connor, the famous swing vote, asked the first question, and her first question for Drew Days was, if we accept this government's position on the constitutionality of this act, what is left of the doctrine of enumerated powers?
Mm-hmm.
Solicitor General Day looked like he'd been kicked in the stomach. We wondered if anybody had mooted him for this argument at all, but there was Sandra Day O'Connor, whose vote is the one you're reaching for, who was right there on enumerated powers, and an opinion came out that revivified that doctrine
yeah.
in a way that hadn't happened in years. So I think on the ground, you're going to get a lot further with enumerated powers.
Well, I just wanted to point that
even I was persuaded by Lopez.
Yeah, good. Okay, with Lopez on one hand and Lawrence on the other, it seems to me that we've got both issues in play. Finally, Randy, you have come down to the famous phrase, ultimately, of deeply rooted in our nation's tradition and history, which of course will get us only so far, and indeed might even undermine some of the agenda that you'd like to see. Would you leave it at deeply rooted in our nation's tradition or history, or do you see the need for the court to go beyond that touchstone by way of fleshing out unenumerated rights?
No, my point was that that's a wholly inadequate standard. That's the standard that the court has hit upon in order to try to cabin its freewheeling discovery of unenumerated rights, because it, after it was subjected to these sorts of criticisms for judicial activism. But I don't. My point is that it's a wholly arbitrary principle in application, because it depends entirely on how you define the right. And if you define the right generally, it will be deeply rooted. If you define the right particularly, it won't be deeply rooted. And so that doctrine simply is inadequate. I do want to. I didn't really address the point that Judge Sentelle asked about in his main talk, in which he just renewed about what is the more likely avenue towards progress as a transition, which I also don't talk about in the book. But I tend to agree. My experience in the Ninth Circuit litigating the medical cannabis cases, I think, supports the fact that we're much more likely to make progress if we enhance the enumerated power scheme than if we try to pursue the unenumerated rights scheme. I'm obviously a big proponent of doing the unenumerated rights part, but we won in the Ninth Circuit on Commerce Clause grounds.
Yes, unless you read the Ninth Circuit as having wanted to put it to the Supreme Court
well,
in the Lopez case.
My goal was to get the Ninth Circuit to think that way
yeah.
and win, and so we could win, and then we'll take the Supreme Court up when that time comes.
Okay.
But I also think I view the Lawrence case in very similar terms. It wasn't so much that the right there was declared to be fundamental. It was simply that because it was declared to be a liberty, that is a conduct that did not obviously harm anybody else, now the burden was shifted to the legislature to justify what it did. It was a burden-shifting move, like is supposed to happen in fundamental rights jurisprudence, and the legislature had no justification beyond its bare judgment that the conduct in question was immoral. And if we allow legislatures to outlaw acts simply because in the opinion of a majority of state legislators that a conduct is simply immoral and nothing more, there is nothing it cannot outlaw. And if there's nothing under a doctrine that a state cannot outlaw, that is a tyrannical doctrine and not one that's consistent with limited government on either the state or federal level.
Okay. Let's now turn it open to you. Please identify yourself when the microphone comes around and any affiliation you may have. Keep your question brief, and please keep your answers brief up here. Let's start right here. Don Wallace.
Don Wallace, Georgetown Law School. A question for Professor Barnett. Would we have been better off if there had been no first eight amendments, no Bill of Rights?
That's a great question. That's one of these hypothetical thought experiments that it's like what original intent people do. They channel the framers and they think what would have happened, how the framers would have decided something. I have to confess, I think not. Here's the argument why we would be. I mean, prior to the adoption of the Bill of Rights, many things were thought to be improper under the Necessary and Proper Clause. There's your text. The whole Bill of Rights essentially could be found in the Necessary and Proper Clause because the law would be improper if it violated these background rights. There might have developed a jurisprudence of judging that would have been judging the propriety of these things in the ways that I've said and would not be cabined or constrained. In the way the Bill of Rights is. In that case, if that had been the counterfactual history, would have been better off. The reason to be concerned that we wouldn't have been better off is that there's no reason to be overly confident that these judges, who are in some sense the heavies of my story. I say in the first sentence of the book, this book would not need to, if judges had been doing their job, this book would not need to have been written. There's no reason to be overly optimistic that they would have done this. And in fact, it seems to be that the safe harbor of textual protections of certain rights have probably made us better off, because in the absence of that, we may have gotten nothing at all.
There's a question right back to the fellow with his hand raised up.
Mike Gravel at the Democracy Foundation. I'd like you to address this concept of the consent of the governed. Now, with respect to the governed, I do not include the court, since they are part of the governing group and the Congress or the executive. Now, in our history, I know of no instance where we've had a determination by the existing governed of their acceptance. And so how can we continue to advance the thesis that our Constitution presently exists at the behest of the consent of the governed, when I know of no procedure for the governed to assert their acceptance?
Well, that is a question that, or that point is a sort of a subset of this general first 45 pages that we've talked about, that has been mentioned. But here's the sense in which I think the consent of the governed idea has proved to be a pernicious one. I mean, it's okay. It was invented for very good reason. The consent of the governed was, or popular sovereignty was invented as a way of constraining the power of kings, which was a good thing. But here's the sense in which it's turned out to be a bad thing. If you have this version of consent, and it turns out in reality no government can meet up, if you really take the point seriously, no government can qualify, including our own. And that's why you see all these sorts of disparagements about what things were like at the founding and how the 14th Amendment might have been ratified or different sorts of things. If you have a standard that no government can meet, then that delegitimates that government. And I believe this is a standard that if you really take it seriously, as critics of the Constitution do when they don't like it, the Constitution won't be able to satisfy, and that undermines its legitimacy. And in fact, what would greatly enhance the legitimacy if we realized it was the procedures that the Constitution puts in place that makes it legitimate, if those procedures are strong enough and good enough to protect the rights retained by the people. I think that the procedures in the Constitution as written have a much stronger case to be made for them than the Constitution that has been redacted by the Supreme Court on that score.
Moreover, the consent criterion can justify too much and too often does.
That's another very serious problem with the consent of the governed. If you take it literally, that in fact the Congress somehow, for example, represents the people, is the people personified, since by consent we can consent to anything, short of alienating our inalienable rights, we can basically consent to everything. If they are us and we are them, then just by passing their laws by majority votes, they can take away all our rights because they're us. That fits fiction is extraordinarily dangerous. And I do talk about that in the first 45 pages, too.
There's a question right here.
Manuel Lopez, not the Lopez, the Lopez case. Just to defend a little bit democracy and the governing by the governed, it seems like you leave out the most important objection to judicial activism that I'm aware of, two important objections. Let me put it this way: first of all, it seems to me that when judges do things, they often do things in a very abstract and ideological way that doesn't end up representing a very prudent policy on issues. Taking the most egregious cases of judicial activism, where they step in and run school boards and order school busing, they make blanket policies on abortion, they direct legislatures to change fundamental laws like marriage. You know, all of these things, it seems to be governed by the bent of lawyers. They're bent for abstractness. They're bent to confuse justice with equality and a kind of logical sense of equality without more complicated considerations that people deliberating would consider. You know, there are other things that are affected in people's lives besides the protection of a particular right that's issue. And the second thing would be the impact on the love of freedom. That the love of freedom is I think, a delicate thing. It has complicated grounds, and one of the grounds of it is that people govern, that they don't feel like they're being, don't defer to being pushed around by bureaucrats, and judges, and lawyers, and that they feel like they, on the most important issues of the day, their say matters. And I just would like you to comment on that.
Well, there's lots to be said about that. It's a very fundamental point, and of the time, I'm not going to be able to say all that could be said about it. But let me just suggest this. And I have a client, Diane Monson. I've never had a client before. I was a prosecutor. My client was the people of the state of Illinois, which is sort of a theoretical client. I have real clients now, although I'm not getting paid. It's pro bono. And my client, Diane Monson, is growing marijuana on her own property to consume herself. And the federal government says she can't do that, and she's a criminal, and they've come to seize her marijuana. And she's suffering from serious illnesses that this marijuana helps alleviate. And she is a law-abiding, small businesswoman, had nothing whatsoever to do with the pot movement or anything like this until she became sick, and she found this worked. Now, the government's telling her she can't do it, over the objection of the state of California, I should say, which says she can do it. The federal government's saying she can. Now, there, I see some bureaucrats now beating up on somebody. I see it right there in our case. And it's only a judge. In our system, there may be other systems I talk about in my first book that might be possible besides the one we have. But in our system, where can she go for redress if not the courts? And if the courts are going to simply say, as they have at every stage of our litigation until the Ninth Circuit ruled for us in our case just a couple months ago, if the judge says, look, that's not my job, that's the job of the legislature to decide, well, Diane Monson is out of luck. The only place in our system where the individual, as opposed to the lobby group, can go to get redress from a grave injustice which is being done to her in this case is a federal court or a state court. But in this case, we're talking about a federal court. And it's only federal judges. If the trial judge denied her relief, it was the Court of Appeals that granted her some relief.
Okay,
And if this is judicial activism, I don't think this is judicial activism. She's not asking the court to do anything but enforce the Constitution. And to me, this is as compelling a case for empowering the individual against the bureaucrats as it would be to empower individuals to lobby in order to pass laws that are going to restrict what their fellow citizens can do.
Can't she go into the voting booth once every 2, 4, or 6 years?
I have just one short comment on that. And it's an area in which I think there's more agreement between Professor Barnett and the member of the audience than has so far been evidenced. When you spoke of the activism of judiciary taking over and running school boards, that is a point to which you find allusion in the text.
Yes.
That there is a difference between a court that stops a government from doing something that's invasive of rights and a court that compels other branches of government to govern in a particular fashion. The courts are supposed to be supreme only in judicial matters. When the courts overstep and begin to tell the other branches of government, the other levels of government, how they should govern, then that is something to which Professor Barnett does address criticism, and I think rightly so.
That's absolutely right. Yes, this gentleman right here.
I'm Jay Baker. Professor Barnett opened his talk with the image of the court mutilating the Constitution by cutting things out. But like modern technology, the court can do harm not only by cutting, but by pasting as well. And one of the pasting that particularly concerns me is with regard to the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment, where they've added the phrase, unless there's a compelling state interest. And I wondered if you could say something about the origin history of this particular pernicious pasting.
I wish I could, but I can't. The book is about liberty and not about the Equal Protection Clause, and so it doesn't discuss the Equal Protection Clause. And one of the I was not an originalist until very late in my career, when I finally became persuaded of the position of originalism, because I was persuaded prior to that of the criticism of originalism. And I believe those criticisms are still valid, but I then identified a different version of originalism that isn't a subject to those criticisms and can be justified on other grounds than are typically offered. But one of the burdens of being an originalist now, I've discovered, is that one can't opine on subjects about which one doesn't really know the history very well. My book doesn't really cover the Equal Protection Clause, and so I can't really say very much authoritative about that. I wish I could. However, I will say this. About just compelling state interest idea in a divorce from the Equal Protection Clause. It's a really pernicious concept, because a compelling state interest is sort of the same thing as saying there's a good reason, there's a good idea. That itself, particularly at the federal level, is a complete evisceration of the enumerated power scheme. The only compelling state interests that are constitutional are the ones on that list. The protection of interstate commerce, the raising and supporting of armies, the establishing of post offices and post roads, those are the only officially approved compelling state interests. All other interests, however compelling they may not be, are not genuinely state interests at the federal level. And at the state level, this gets us into the issue of what is the proper conception of the police power. And in the chapter on that, I argue that the proper conception of the police power is limited to the government protecting the rights of each of us from others, from those of others, something a power the federal government does not have, but state governments do have. They not only have the power, but the duty to protect each of our rights from being violated by others. That is the only compelling state interest that states may instantiate. So I think the doctrine the concept you've alluded to is extremely dangerous, because it removes all constraint on the exercise of power at either the state or the federal level.
It's one more of the products of footnote 4 in strict scrutiny. Next question. Right in the back there, you see the hands?
My name is Andy Hawks, and I'm an attorney by profession. I don't mean to ask an unduly technical question, but one of the legal doctrines, it seems to me, that makes it so difficult to restore the lost Constitution is the lack of taxpayer standing to sue. To give you a concrete example, the Cato Institute issued a statement recently criticizing funding for the arts, federal funding for the arts, which strikes me as a classic example of unconstitutional spending. But I don't think there's anyone in this room who could file a lawsuit to stop it. Do you address the problem of standing in your book, or
no.
If you have any comments on it?
It's a very good question. I don't have an answer to it. I mean, I'm open to the argument of others. I know the issue, but I don't have a considered judgment on the matter. I will say this, that even in our medical cannabis case, we held our breath on the standing issue, notwithstanding the fact that one of my clients had her plant seized under current standing doctrine. If the judges of the Ninth Circuit had wanted to, they might have made my life difficult by asking me about that. I think we had good answers, but they were answers that if a court had wanted to reject, they might have rejected. So I know enough about standing to know I don't know enough about standing doctrine to have a reformist proposal that I could make today. I do think you're right, though. It is something that is, and I encourage those of you who are here who are interested in research topics and want to advance the cause of liberty to examine that topic seriously.
Sure, and it was one of the great reasons that the general welfare clause has been expanded is because there was no standing. A taxpayer had to challenge it. Walter, you wanted to add?
Yes, I do. I think this is an area that really does define the differences we may have over taxpayer standing. I'm sympathetic to the substance of the question. It does trouble me that we have an agency that engages in basically censorship. It decides what projects it will reject and what projects it will fund based on whether it approves of the message being conveyed. So I oddly find that, it may be odd, but I do find that troubling. Taxpayer standing, it does seem to me, really turns the justification for judicial review on its head. And Marshall said, the only reason we as courts have the authority, Marshall and Marbury against Madison, the reason we have the authority to say what the Constitution means is because we have a job to do. The job is to resolve disputes among two people with a real dispute. Here's a guy that says he deserves the commission to be a justice of the peace. Here's this other guy who's withholding it from him. We've got to resolve that dispute. That's the only reason. We have to apply law, and the Constitution is law. What Flass versus Cohen, where the court partially expanded taxpayer standing, says, and the Warren Court is to challenge expenditures to religious institutions. The Warren Court turns that upside down and says between the lines, our job is to enunciate the meaning of the Constitution, and we have to find a case in order to do it. And I think that turns the justification of judicial review on its head and greatly expands it in ways that I would find troubling, and it's one of the differences. Yeah. Let me get some help here from my fellow Tariel.
Yeah, again, consistent with your text, the judiciary is supposed to be supreme only in matters that are judicial. When they are judicial, you have a real case or controversy between people litigating their personal rights. When you have the political question of whether particular program should be funded in the first instance, you don't have a concrete controversy between persons whose personal rights are invaded in the way that makes it a justiciable question. There's not much use in having a legislature, having vetoes, if you can then bring every question to the court and say, well, I don't really have an ox being gored, but this is a bad law, and as a citizen, my rights are being violated that you passed a bad law, you're spending taxpayer money, whatever you do, therefore the courts then become open to everything. We're no longer courts, we're a super legislature, a super veto power, and I think the standing doctrine is one that performs more good than it does ill. I think when you take away the plant, I don't have that case, but it sounds to me like they're standing. And let me say, if you read my cases on standing, if I think they're standing, you're not going to lose many judges, because you would not like most of my standing doctrine cases, and I wrote most of the recent ones in D.C., but our function is to adjudicate judicial cases, not to go into the philosophy behind good and bad laws.
Well, how then, David, would you handle the general welfare clause problem? The question whether it is an independent power on the part of Congress to spend for the general welfare, Hamilton.
It's not.
Well, good.
That's how it would happen.
Yeah, but of course, in Butler, they decided in dicta the other way, and then in Halvering, they raised the dicta up to the holding of the case. But the great problem under the general welfare clause was that nobody had standing to challenge the abuse of the general
welfare
clause.
You're forgetting the right to vote.
Yeah.
Well, then you see the question of the interpretation of whether it's an independent power or not is not a question of constitutional interpretation or construal. It's rather a political issue.
No, I can say, a candidate ought to run saying that we've gone off the track. Some of you approve of some of this general welfare spending, some of you do not, but I'm saying I'm going to institute a government that is going to be more restrained. I mean, you show so little faith in the people that we can't use that as an argument in an election. I mean, the premise of the question, by the way, was exactly right. It is the limits on standing that reduce the judicial role and therefore the enforceability of some of these. Yeah. We just differ on whether we think that's on balance a good or bad thing. We do agree with the premise of your
Randy,
question.
Randy, would you solve this problem?
No, I want to emphasize something. The book that I've written and which is under discussion today is a very ambitious book. It covers an awful lot of territory. But it doesn't cover all territory. It is not a theory of everything constitutional. It is limited to the following subject. What should the approach, what is the correct constitutional approach when the government is commanding us to do or stop doing something, when the government is telling us what to do or what we may not do? That's a direct, that's the issue of liberty. There are many.
Then you have standing.
Then standing is not a problem. And that's the subject of my book. It's not about the Equal Protection Clause, which is another part of the Constitution that's extremely important, but that's not the subject of my book, which has to do with when can government give privileges to some and not give them to others, and when it must treat all the people, and what is a rational classification, what is not. It's not about that. It's not about the General Welfare Clause either. And so as ambitious as it is only about liberty. And that means that there are other books to be written on these other subjects.